The next item of business is portfolio question time, and the portfolio on this occasion is net zero and just transition. I would invite any member wishing to ask a supplementary question to press the request to speak button during the relevant question. And I call question number one from James Dornan.
To ask the Scottish Government what progress it has made towards developing a just transition plan for energy.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the draft Energy Strategy and Just Transition Plan was published for consultation on the 1st of January this year, setting out our vision for an energy transition that responds to the climate emergency, but which is fair. A very high number of responses to the consultation have been received. An independent analysis of these is currently being carried out. We will fully consider the stakeholders' view as we develop the final strategy and plan.
James Dornan.
Okay, thank you very much, Minister. Thank you for that reply, Cabinet Secretary. Do you agree with me that the £7 million of Scottish Government funding for projects such as a study into treating water from the River Clyde to produce cheap hydrogen and the creation of a hydrogen hub in Glasgow Airport for storage and distribution will greatly help create renewable and lower carbon hydrogen production by 2030?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the £7 million of funding recently offered by the Scottish Government's Hydrogen Innovation Scheme to 32 innovative projects, such as those mentioned by Mr Dornan, will help to drive technological progress and advance innovation, supporting our ambition of 5 gigawatts of renewable and low-carbon hydrogen production by 2030. These projects will progress innovative solutions to address and overcome key challenges related to scaling up hydrogen production, storage and distribution in Scotland.
Thank you. There's a number of supplementaries. I'll hopefully get through all of them, but they'll need to be brief. First, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. £25 million has been allocated to the Scottish Government's Just Transition Fund, but unlike previous funding rounds, that's being assessed and distributed by the Scottish National Investment Bank rather than provided direct to support projects. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, for what reason did the Government abandon the initial process, and what does it say to companies who missed out the first time round, who now see the goalposts has shifted?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I can reassure the member that the Scottish Government has abandoned no process. The £75 million that have been made available so far are part of a £500 million fund over a decade. I hope that Liam Kerr isn't casting doubt on the Scottish National Investment Bank to invest the £25 million well. And I should challenge him on his colleague's contribution to the Just Transition in Scotland, which has been left sorely wanting to date.
Mercedes Villalba.
Offshore trade unions, the RMT and Unite the Union are working with APITO, environmental organisations and others on the introduction of a much-needed offshore training passport to provide a clear pathway for oil and gas workers to transition into renewables. The Energy Minister was unable to confirm whether the offshore training passport will align offshore safety standards. So will the Cabinet Secretary take action to ensure that all developers of wind farms leased through the ScotWind process recognise the digital offshore training passport when it comes online in the autumn?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the raison d'etre of the skills passport is about that inter-reliability and inter-recognition. So I absolutely agree with the principle behind Mercedes Villalba's question, that we want these to make the process a great deal easier for workers. And I am certainly looking into that matter, as I am looking into the delivery of the skills passport generally. And I would just assure Ms Villalba, I would assure the Chamber that the involvement of our trade unions in our just transition, and in particular in this case in the oil and gas transition, is absolutely critical. That's why we have trade union representatives as part of the Just Transition Commission. It's why we're funding, for example, two posts within the STUC to ensure that the Scottish Government is cognisant of workers' views and their needs in this important transition.
And Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that, having received significant public money, the Wood Group, based in Aberdeen, is now increasing its fossil fuel extraction processes and reducing its shift to renewables. How can we ensure that our public money does not support, even indirectly, increasing use of fossil fuels at a time of the climate emergency?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I understand that the Wood Group was awarded a UK government-backed £430 million green transition loan in August 21. However, to be clear, no funding has been provided directly to Wood Group through the Just Transition Fund. Through the fund, we will, of course, be supporting the wider energy transition, which could include companies that are diversifying away from fossil fuel activities. I believe that this approach, this inclusive approach, this everybody getting around the table recognising the scale of the challenge approach is critical to a transition which is truly fair, but equally rises to the imperative of the climate emergency.
Question 2, Ivan McKee.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Net Zero Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues in relation to maximising any benefits of the transition to net zero across the economy, including Scotland's manufacturing sector?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government sees the just transition to net zero not just as an environmental imperative, it certainly is that, but it's also a massive economic opportunity. And I engage regularly with my ministerial colleagues on the issue and have established a monthly meeting with the Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing, Economy, Fair Work and Energy, which covers how we maximise these opportunities. On the manufacturing sector in particular, ministerial colleagues are supporting several initiatives. In particular, the First Minister will formally open the flagship building for the National Manufacturing Institute of Scotland on the 21st of June, which is a significant milestone for the project and for the sector.
Ivan McKee.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and it's great that NMIS will be formally opening in the coming days. Scotland, of course, is well placed to benefit economically from the transition to net zero, but to realise these benefits, the Scottish Government needs to lead on ensuring the policies on decarbonising heat and transport are aligned with industrial strategies to help build Scotland's manufacturing capabilities, for example, through the Government Supply Chain Development Programme. So I'd like to ask the Cab Sec what specific work has been done to ensure this alignment happens. Is the work on the Supply Chain Development Programmes continuing, and where are the priority areas for delivering that industrial development?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the Government's National Strategy for Economic Transformation, which I know Ivan McKee played a key role in, it sets out our commitment to realising the opportunities which he rightly has identified lie in front of Scotland in the green energy transition. As the Member mentions, our Supply Chain Development Programme aims to align economy and innovation policy interventions with public sector spend, using both more strategically to improve the capacity and capability of Scottish manufacturing supply chains. And just as by way of example, I would point to the recently launched Low Carbon Manufacturing Challenge Fund, which is a £26 million fund over 5 years, available for innovative proposals to reduce the carbon output of manufacturing in Scotland.
And briefly, Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the scale and urgency needed to decarbonise our homes in an affordable way, what work is the Scottish Government doing with local authorities to set targets and work with suppliers so we get that retrofitting and renewables in our communities, particularly thinking about solar technology, heat pumps and wind turbines and the infrastructure for heat networks, because we need those jobs in our communities now?
Cabinet Secretary.
I absolutely agree that local authorities have a critical role to play in the delivery of what is an enormous change agenda in front of us as a country. Scottish Government, local authorities, the public sector generally have a critical role to play, and I was really pleased to recently speak at a forum of public sector in Scotland where we explored all of the ways that we need to work together, the synergies that we need to make sure are in place, but equally making sure that there is scope for different regional and local authority priorities to arise out of that. For example, I have no doubt that there will be different approaches required in the decarbonisation of transport between urban, rural and island Scotland.
Question 3, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of recent water scarcity updates from SEPA, which state that the majority of Scotland is now affected by water scarcity, what assessment is made of the impact of water scarcity conditions on peatland restoration and the ability to sequester carbon?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the issue of water scarcity is a very serious one, and I'll be glad to touch more specifically on that should Mr Whittle wish to. But on the matter of peatland restoration, there are currently plans for the James Hutton Institute to model the potential for water scarcity to impact peatland, and also spatial analysis to identify areas of peatland which are or may become vulnerable to drought and fire risk. These projects are scheduled to report in 2024 and 2025 respectively and are funded as part of the Scottish Government's £250 million Environment, Natural Resource and Agriculture Strategic Research Programme.
Brian Whittle.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Research has shown that drier conditions not only reduce the amount of carbon that peatland can sequester, but can negatively impact biodiversity within the wider range of teal carbon habitats across Scotland, including riparian woodlands, wetlands and ponds. So can I ask what progress has been made since the water shortages in summer 2022 to improve management for biodiversity within wetland habitats, especially under the fact that 90% of freshwater ponds have disappeared over the last 100 years?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I thank Mr Whittle for the question and for raising an important point. We know that peatlands, when wet, are capable of sequestering carbon, supporting biodiversity, and it figures therefore that in drought conditions and when they are dried out, those benefits are lost. And of course, that's part of what the Scottish Government's £250 million of funding in peatland restoration is seeking to alleviate. On the matter of preparedness for drought and water scarcity conditions over the summer, I work very closely with SEPA on that matter, and just this afternoon I've written out to MSPs inviting them to a factual briefing session next week on the range of matters which may come to our constituents' attention as these dry conditions are due to persist.
And brief supplementary, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you. Sorry, Presiding Officer. Restoration of peatland in Scotland is vital for our biodiversity, and I welcome the £250 million investment the Scottish Government has made to restore 250,000 hectares of peatland to 2030. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what work has been undertaken to ensure our restoration of peatland is responsive to the risks of global warming and climate change, such as the water scarcity, amongst others?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, as I was narrating in response to Brian Whittle, water scarcity linked to climate change clearly puts wetland ecosystems, including peatlands, at risk of drying and degradation. And Jackie Dunbar is absolutely right to mention the investment that the Scottish Government currently makes in peatland restoration. Full funding, I should say, public sector funding available for projects. But as we take that action to mitigate emissions, as peatland restoration does, we must also be adapting to climate change that is already embedded. And of course, changing weather patterns, water scarcity is increasingly a significant adaptation issue, and the Government is committed to keeping abreast of it.
Question number four, Ariane Burgess.
To ask the Scottish Government how it's encouraging local authorities across the country to follow the lead of Highland Council in rolling out the 20-mile-per-hour speed limit in built-up areas.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
The Scottish Government committed to develop a national strategy for 20-mile-an-hour speed limits, which supports the commitments in the 2021 Bute House Agreement and the 2022 Programme for Government. We welcome Highland Council's enthusiasm as early adopters of the strategy, and we do want to see more areas of Scotland benefit too. So, in addition to the £1.4 million which was allocated to road authorities in the last financial year to help them identify the number of roads affected and to assess the financial implications, we will also be providing funding to all road authorities to fully implement 20-mile-an-hour speed limits by 2025.
Ariane Burgess.
I thank the Minister for that encouraging response. 118 communities will benefit from Highland Council's rollout of the 20-mile-per-hour speed limits. Could the Minister share how the working group is progressing to ensure more councils roll out these schemes alongside investments in high-quality active travel routes, such as those recently completed at the Inverness campus and Rigmore?
Minister.
Yes, indeed. 20-mile-an-hour speed limits in cities, towns and villages, particularly in places where vulnerable road users and vehicles mix, is internationally recognised as a key element in reducing road casualties and creating safe conditions for people to walk, wheel and cycle. The multi-partner task group, which includes membership from Scots and COSLA, as well as various active travel and sustainable travel partners, agreed that while conducting the road assessments, these wider policy objectives should all be considered.
Question number five, Alexander Burnett.
Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on any increase in water quality testing that is proposed for rivers in the North East, and I refer members to my register of interest regarding the River Dee.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, although I wasn't the Minister at the time, it's my understanding that in November 2022, CEPRA provided the member with detailed information of summarised sample numbers for water quality testing from 2017 to 2022, and CEPA's projections for 2023 sample numbers, as he's asked for, indicate an increase of approximately 50% compared to 2022 levels for total samples across all Scotland, including the North East.
Alexander Burnett.
There are 42 wastewater treatment works and 99 sewage discharge points on the River Don, and 26 wastewater treatment works and 69 sewage discharge points on the River Dee. None of these have a requirement or licensing condition from CEPA for Scottish Water to report discharge data at these locations. So can I ask why not, and when will Scottish Water be required to report sewage discharge data for these rivers?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, as I've reported to Parliament previously, Scottish Water's Improving Urban Waters route map, published in December 21, sets out a programme of continued action to reduce wastewater pollution and sewage litter over the coming decade, and that's backed by £500 million of investment. And the first annual update to the route map was published in December 2022. Now, as regards the upgrades within that scheme that are committed to for CSOs, they are targeting some of the most problematic, and I think that's the right thing to do. But I don't want us ever to lose sight of the fact that as we strive for improvement, we are starting from a very high base, where, as I again have said before, CEPA's recent results show 66% of Scotland's water bodies in good condition or better, compared to just 16% in England.
With a reminder, this is a question about water quality in the North East. I call Fosil Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. A recent Marine Conservation report noted that only 4% of Scotland's sewage discharge points are monitored. The overspilling of sewages and recent heavy rainfall have left the water in Leith potentially dangerous. Residents have no idea that impact this is having on their health and on their environment. Will the Cabinet Secretary also commit to having the water in Leith tested by a public body so that the residents can know the condition of their water?
Well, confirming that Leith is not in the North East, I would invite the Cabinet Secretary to provide a response if she's so
North East of Edinburgh. No, I'm happy to answer the question, Presiding Officer, because it's an important one. And I understand that monitoring is regarded as a very important part of our sewer network, and I understand why. However, Scottish Water was able to make a decision some years ago. Do you monitor every outlet, or do you invest that money in making improvements? And Scotland has done the latter. Now, Fosil Chowdhury is asking me to make sure that a public body monitors the water quality. That's exactly what the independent Scottish Environment Protection Agency does. And as I narrated in response to my last question, the results of that are really rather good for Scotland.
Question number 6 has not been lodged. Question number 7, Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what funding it will make available for community-led initiatives in the Coatbridge and Crising constituency that promote environmental quality and protection.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, a range of funding is available to support community-led initiatives to promote environmental quality. For example, the Vacant and Derelict Land Investment Programme awarded North Lanarkshire Council £230,000 in 22-23 for the Glen Manor Green Space Project. This supported adjacent communities in Moodysburn and Cryston, creating a green space for outdoor education, play, active travel and biodiversity. The fund is currently open again to applications from all local authorities to support community-led regeneration, and I would encourage those local authorities to bid.
Fulton MacGregor.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I welcome her mention of the Glen Manor project there, which was an absolutely fantastic example. My constituency is home to many community-led environmental initiatives, including also the Friends of Monklands Canal Group, who recently won the Most Improved Walking Place at the recent Scottish Walking Awards. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the Scottish Government should encourage community participation in such initiatives via increased funding, promotion and other avenues?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'd like to take the opportunity to congratulate Monklands Canal Group on their award, and I very much agree with Fulton MacGregor that involving communities in shaping their neighbourhoods should be strongly encouraged. In fact, I think there's no other way of going about it. This is very much in line with our planning policies, which aim to encourage more people to live well locally, as well as funding programmes which help local people to improve their own places. Partnership working with community groups is key to promoting increased use and enjoyment of our outdoor spaces, and we've committed to increase funding to £320 million in 2024-25 to increase active travel opportunities for community groups and local authorities alike, and my colleague Patrick Harvey is ably overseeing that work.
And question number 8, Michelle Thompson.
To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to make the community central to its plans for a just transition for Grangemouth.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, our commitment to develop a just transition for the Grangemouth industrial complex acknowledges the critical role that we think Grangemouth plays in Scotland's journey to net zero, utilising existing industrial heritage, infrastructure and manufacturing excellence. A strong partnership between industry, unions, the workforce and local communities will be a critical success factor for Grangemouth, given the long-standing and interwoven relationship between the cluster and the wider town, and that's something the Scottish Government wholeheartedly supports.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Minister for that answer, and I know there's a multitude of bodies at the moment that aim to give voice to the community. But despite this, the Economy and Fair Work Committee has heard clear evidence that at this stage the community feels excluded from what a just transition could mean for them, especially when they know that they host Scotland's largest industrial site, accounting for around 4% of Scotland's GDP. So will the Minister commit to ensuring the development of a co-design process with not just regular input from the community but also feedback to them to highlight where their input has influenced decision-making, and will she further ensure specific measures of success from a community perspective are put in place up front?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, very happy to answer the various parts of that question. Firstly, I think that baselining and monitoring thereafter is a really critical part of how we measure a just transition generally. In my view, Grangemouth is a symbol of the need for a just transition to net zero. It's got unique economic importance. It's the home to a cluster of strategic manufacturing assets in energy, petrochemicals, and it's our largest logistics hub. It also employs thousands of people. But equally, it contributes rather significantly to industrial emissions, which must be driven down, and that must happen rapidly. If I can give one example of our commitment to a community-led just transition, we have decided to fund a community just transition participation officer for Grangemouth, employed from the community to liaise with the just transition process to make sure that it is always responding to community need.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.